Hello, yeah, good afternoon, everybody. My name is Miguel. I'm a master's student in data science at the University of Amsterdam, and I wrote my master's thesis on the Parliament corpus. So the Parliament's mission was to create comparable multilingual corpora of parliamentary debates, and we figured it would be highly interesting to evaluate the feasibility of the comparative aspect on the Parliament corpus. So yeah, what we did in our study is I would like to share four results with you. And the first thing we did is to create a high-level overview of the corpus. Since your data set is such new, is a newly released data set, we wanted to create an overview not only for ourselves to really understand the data, but also to allow other researchers to identify interesting fields and see what they can do with the data. And in order to see if there are any unique characteristics found within the Parliament corpus, we take a look at their grammatical markup using the part of speech tag distributions found in the annotated data set. And we compare those distributions against a background corpus such as the Wikipedia dumps. And as last, we also evaluate the role of women within Parliament. And why this is important, I will get back to shortly. And as a last thing, we compare how the different parliaments handle societal impactful topics such as migration, climate, and corona. So to start off with the overview, we first take it at a very high level. And we earlier saw Thomas explaining the structure of the parliament files. And we see, for example, that text is structured into segments and utterances, where a segment may contain one or multiple utterances. And what we did is we simply project all these segments per debate per parliament. You can see all the parliaments listed on the x-axis in alphabetical order. And we distinguish the debates by being before or during the pandemic. And we see that there's not a lot of fluctuations and everything seems to be going on quite regularly. And when we move on to the utterances, we can see actually that the number is a bit higher, but we can see relatively the same pattern. And this is to be expected as one a segment may have multiple utterances. Yeah, and then to continue down the overview, we take a look at the words per sentence and we simply count the amount of words found within one sentence. And by looking at the box plots, we can see that we do observe some faulty sentence tokenizations. As for example, in the Danish parliament, we can see that one sentence has almost 5,000 words, and that will be a little bit long for just a sentence, given it's a spoken word data set. So these are some minor errors we may want to fix in a later version. Yeah, and as a last thing, so we've taken first a look at the debate level and we zoom down all the way to the characters and we simply count the characters per word per parliament. And this exposes some of the linguistical differences between the parliaments, which may be interesting to, for example, compare against another background corpora or for more analytical research, linguistical research, I meant to say. Yeah, so one of the analysis we did based on the overview is by comparing the post tag distributions. What we did is from the annotated data set, we just counted all of the post tags and computed their percentual share. And by means of a string graph, we can very easily compare the post tag distributions between the different parliaments. Each post tag, each stream within this string graph represents a different post tag. And what we're looking for is a more generalized conclusion to say if we're seeing anything unique. And so basically what we did is we post-tagged Wikipedia dumps of corresponding languages, and we started to compare the two distributions. So in the next figure, what we basically did is we, on the next slide, yeah. So we basically project each post-tag if it differs at least 20% relatively and 2% absolutely between the Parliament corpus and the Wikipedia dumps. And if the point is projected in the positive region, it means that it occurred more frequently in the Parliament corpus. And what we really see is that the verbs, adverbs, and proper nouns are quite densely populated in the positive region, meaning that they occur more frequently in the Parliament corpus as opposed to Wikipedia dumps, while proper nouns are quite densely populated in the negative region, meaning they occur more frequently in the Wikipedia corpus. So that's quite a unique characteristic of the grammatical markup, but we also want to do some societal investigation. So we basically wondered what the role of women in parliament is. And women in parliament are actually quite important. Female members of parliament represent a heard or marginalized women's interest, placed women's issues on the agenda, and added a feminine perspective to existing discussions. And that's based on a study named A Feminized Language of Democracy, the Representation of Women at Westminster since 1945. And what we also found out is using a study of the Dutch 2021 elections is that female party leaders received less attention than male party leaders. So what we asked ourselves is it true that this reflects itself as well within the parliament itself? Do women receive less attention than males? So what we wanted to do with the parliament corpus is measure if women receive equal attention as their male colleagues in parliament using the parliament corpus. And what we found out is by summarizing the results in a table from the different populations, is that we can immediately see that we must discriminate the members of parliament based on their parliamentary position. This is especially present in the Dutch parliament, where you see, for example, that male ministers tend to speak 140,000 words per year, whilst female ministers only speak 77,000 words per year. So you can see there's quite a difference in the means, not only between the genders, but also the parliamentary positions. Yes. So in the next figure, please. So what we did is we projected all of these research groups on a box plot, and we can already see that the means tend to be higher for the males in Denmark, France, and the Netherlands, whilst in Great Britain the opposite tends to be true. And please be aware, these differences may seem very small, but the y-axis is on a log scale, so these differences are actually much bigger than they visually appear to be. So for regular members of parliament, we can already hypothesize that males tend to speak more. And in the next figure, we also take a look at the ministers. And we can kind of see the same pattern, only that for the France parliament, we're only able to identify three ministers, which kind of makes faulty results. But also in Great Britain, we now tend to see a higher mean for the women as opposed to the males. Yeah, and to validate our claim, we basically hypothesized that in the null hypothesis, there's no difference between their means. And in the alternative hypothesis, we accept that males speak more than females on average. So to do this, we conducted a t-test. And so we weren't able to compute the p-value for the French ministers, but depending on where you set the significance level, let's say we set it at 0.05, then only in the Netherlands, we say that we accept the claim that male ministers tend to speak more than female ministers, whilst looking at regular members of parliament, for all parliaments, males speak more than female members of parliament, except for Great Britain, where it doesn't seem to be true for either of the ministers or regular members of parliament. So a logical, interesting question would be, are women's issues a more frequent topic agenda in the Parliament of Great Britain as opposed to the other parliaments? And then basically the last thing we did is we wanted to compare societal topics between the parliaments, but there's a hurdle to multilingual corpora. As I said before, the parliament corpus contains 17 parliaments with 16 languages, and these 16 languages can actually be categorized into four alphabets. So this makes it quite hard to just textually compare the semantics and refer to the same real-world entity when we're discussing these different corpora. So what could we do? We could Google Translate everything, but it will become quite costly as the parliament corpus has millions of words. And therefore, it would kind of deter the reproducibility of the study. So what we chose to do is use neural machine translations. And I won't really get into the details as it's quite technical, but we achieved okay results with understandable to good translations. And the what we then did is we trained a topic model to basically extract corona, climate, and migration topics from the debates. And then we were able to compare them against the parliaments. So the first thing we did is we aggregated all of the topic scores for all the parliaments for the corona topic. And we can see some precision errors found by the model in the Italian parliament. So it didn't perform quite well there. We can see little blobs, but you can see from starting at the first quarter of 2020 that the corona topic really starts to grow in attention given to it within the parliaments. And it kind of dictates really well to a crisis. The second topic we analyzed is climate. And this is actually a really interesting topic. When you're looking at the general trend line, you can see the stream marginally expanding over time. But then as we enter 2021, it starts to shrink quite rapidly. And we can't really say for sure that this is due to the pandemic, but at least we can say that at times of pandemic, the general attention given to the climate topic throughout the parliaments has been reducing. Yeah, and as last, we take a look at migration. And from the migration topic, we can see that it actually tends to fluctuate a bit more, a lot more than seen in the climate topic, but it seems to be going at a quite a consistent rate, even despite the pandemic. Yes, and then the last question I would like to ask you, just to think about for yourself, is it's easy to get lost in all of these numbers and by looking at all of the aggregated counts, but there's also a societal question to be answered using these figures. And something to think about is in the past 30 years, we've emitted 50% of all CO2 emissions since 1751. And we've been climate aware for just 32 years. So there was a recent lawsuit against the Shell company in the Netherlands that they were obligated to reduce their CO2 emissions. And in the next slide, we showed the reasoning for the Dutch court to process that. And they say that climate change affects human rights, including the right to live. And the court rules that companies such as Shell must respect these rights and therefore is obligated to reduce its emissions. And since politics was unable to enforce any real climate change policy over the past 30 years, they ruled that they were allowed to interfere with a legal judgment. And therefore, it may be a good question to think about for yourself. And that is it a good thing that law starts to interfere with climate change instead of solely relying on politics to get the job done, especially when we look at the general trend of attention given to climate and see it shrink so rapidly when priorities start to shift. So that was it for my part of the presentation. And I would like to thank you a lot for listening.